Robin Reyes, Bachelor of Music.
Fallon Hoggett, Omega Institute of Cosmetology.
Priscilla Morsell, Omega Institute of Cosmetology.
Anna Warren, Opelousas School of Cosmetology.
Erin Fleming, Guns Academy.
Sue Birch, Guys Report Academy.
Bernie Lejeune, Omega Institute.
That will, if Ms. Brown, if you would mind, give us an indication, please.
Lord, we come today asking you to look over this meeting. May we make just and sound decisions. We ask you and thank you for this in your name. Amen.
Thank you. Roll call, please.
Edwin Neal.
Present.
Jill A. Bear.
Present.
Mella Brown.
Present.
Frances Hand, absent. Kevin Martin.
Present.
Melinda Tilly, absent. Michael Grayson.
Present.
James Williams, absent. Five board members present, and there is a quorum.
Thank you. Do we hear a motion to accept the agenda?
I'll make the motion to accept the agenda.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
The agenda is accepted. And next, we need a motion to approve the August 5th, 2019 board meeting minutes.
I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes of the August 5th, 2019 meeting.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
The minutes are approved. Ms. Cangelis, do you want to take us through the consent agreements?
Yes.
Hello.
Okay, Sassy Nails was a matter set for hearing today. Sassy Nails is a manicuring salon in Brule, Louisiana. They had some prior violations, and on one occasion when the inspector was in there, they had a dog in the salon. On the next occasion when the inspector was in there, they had two unlicensed operators. Both the salon and the owner are paying fines and cost of $1,150, and the licenses are going to be on probation for a year. That's one of the ones that was set for hearing today. Also, another one that wasn't on the agenda is Goff Estates. It's G-O-F-F Estates LLC doing business as Scale, S-K-A-L-E. Well, it's Upscale, S-K-A-L-E Beauty Salon. And it's a cosmetology salon in Lake Charles. They had one unlicensed operator working as an esthetician applying eyelashes. They're paying a fine and cost, the owner and the salon, of $550 each, and the license is on probation for a year. It's just, it's not the owner in the salon, it's just the salon in that case, because the owner was a corporation. Tasha, I don't have the ones you have on your agenda.
There's Kosha Smith, Kosha's unique nail, and then there's Kim Lee, PGA Feather Salon.
Okay. My agenda says blink out loud, that's my confusion. Okay, Nicosia Smith doing business as Coco's Unique Nails and Hair Salon in New Orleans. It's a manicuring salon. They had an unlicensed worker working as a cosmetologist braiding hair at the manicuring salon when the inspector was there on April 2nd, 2019. They're paying a fine and cost of $750, and the license is on probation for a year. Then Cam Lee is doing business as Fetish Salon in Houma, Louisiana. It's a cosmetology salon. On the date the inspector was in there, they failed to display the cosmetologist license of an individual, Rusty Benoit, in a conspicuous space. And that was on March 14, and Ms. Benoit was working there at the time. So they're paying a fine and cost of $550, and their license is on probation for a year. That's all I have.
Thank you. Will we hear a motion to approve the consent agreements?
I make that motion to approve the consent agreement.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
The agreements are approved. Next, Ms. Angelosi, I know we had several hearings with you. Do we still have a hearing today?
The first two, we had Sassy Nails and its owner. That was one of the ones we got a consent agreement on this morning. You just approved the consent agreement. It's settled. On Morgan Nails, we've dismissed those charges after talking to the people today and resolving their issue. On Sabella Borges, B-O-R-G-E-S, it's a student working at a cosmetology salon. The student working unlicensed and owning the cosmetology salon that's unlicensed. This lady's not here yet, and I don't know if she's going to come or not. On the last case, Ebony Brown, doing business as Essence of Beauty, that's an unlicensed salon. Ms. Brown called the board office this morning and indicated that she couldn't make it today because she had the flu. So because of that, and she's never asked for a continuance before, I'm going to ask that we continue it till the October meeting. So the only one I have to try, is that the pleasure of the board to continue it?
Yeah. Okay. I mean, I don't think we need to, you can agree with this. Mm-hmm. You don't need our approval on that.
I've done that. And so the only one I have left is Sabella Borges, and I'd like to give her some time to see if she shows up.
Okay. So we'll come back to that at the end of the meeting and see if there's anyone here to make an appearance.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Next is our old business, and the first item on the agenda is dermaplaning, microneedling, and nanoinfusion. Are we going to see a PowerPoint on that?
Yay!
Excellent.
Look at this right now, just past the line for me to turn the lights back on.
This is not quite as long as going with the wind.
It's not that bad. We should be done in less than 8 minutes. All right.
We can get started.
This is something I've never seen before.
They're trying to do this in all of the salons, man. Oh, it should go down.
First up, microneedling. Microneedling, also known as skin needling, collagen induction therapy, and/or dermal rolling, is an invasive medical cosmetic procedure that stimulates collagen production by causing micro injuries to the skin. The procedure uses very fine needles to puncture the skin in various depths to cause a controlled injury and inducing the skin to make more collagen, resulting in a clearer complexion. Microneedling can be done by using a pin-like tool called a dermapen. The dermapen has tiny needles at the end that make little holes or needle pricks in the top layers of your skin with adjustable depths between 0.5 millimeters and 2.5 millimeters. Microneedling can also be done using a derma roller, which looks like a miniature paint roller with lots of tiny needles. And the derma roller is gently rolled in different directions over the surface of your skin to achieve the same effect as it would be with a derma roller. I'm sorry, a derma pen. All right. For decades, microneedling has been done, performed by a dermatologist, so it's not a new thing. It is used for treatment for facial scars, wrinkles, enlarged pores, amongst other conditions. An improper technique and or practices can cause scarring, infections, skin irritations, and or rashes. This procedure requires multiple treatments to achieve any of the aforementioned benefits. So basically, a dermapen or a derma roller is used to poke holes into the skin, causing micro injuries, which in turn causes collagen production, which forms new skin. The holes penetrate the dermis of the skin, though. They do go past the epidermis, like once you get the holes. Questions?
So it penetrates the dermis, does it go into the subcutaneous tissue?
It does not.
It does not, but
it penetrate possibly the dermis. Could, because it's 2.5 millimeters. It's like the largest needle, and it depends on the thickness of the person's, you know. Yeah.
Is there a question from the...
And that's a microneedle.
Microneedle. All right, next is nano infusion. Nano infusion, also known as transdermal serum infusion, nano needling, and or microchanneling. It is a non-invasive transdermal serum delivery system designed to rejuvenate your skin and remedy many common issues like lack of tone, uneven texture, excessive pigmentation, scarring, and loss of elasticity. Nano infusion is a less aggressive, no needle alternative to microneedling. This type of treatment instantly allows up to 1,000% more absorption of the product used. And the nano infusion process is done with a handheld device or a pen. It's a derma pen. It just doesn't penetrate as much as the microneedling pen. That moves the nano cartridge up and down onto the surface of the skin. And the nano needling only affects the epidermis, treating within the upper 0.25 millimeters of the skin. The nano infusion cartridge encompasses 81 silicone tips as opposed to microneedling, which actually uses needles. These microscopic hair-like cones separate the cells within the epidermis to allow active products to be pushed into the skin. This treatment can be done weekly to exfoliate. Questions? Last we have dermaplaning. Dermaplaning, also known as skin planing, is a manual exfoliation technique. It is a controlled scraping of the skin to remove keratinized cells on the scratum corneum as well as small fine hairs. In layman's terms, dermaplaning removes layers of dead skin and what many refer to as peach fuzz. Trained professionals, such as dermatologists, use a sterile 10-gauge scalpel held at a 45-degree angle with gentle feathering strokes to accomplish this. So dermaplaning can benefit areas of hyperpigmentation, dry skin, aged spots, fine lines, and enlarged pores, amongst other skin issues. Dermaplaning is considered superficial, but once a professional provides a peel, the treatment is no longer superficial, and the peel will reach layers deeper than the epidermis. Improper procedure can cause cuts, nicks, and scarring. And this procedure can be done every couple of weeks, provided that it is not done with a peel. Effects can last up to 4 weeks. So dermaplaning is scraping of the skin, and it does not exceed beyond the epidermis. However, the question will be regarding the allowance of the blade, because you do actually have to use a blade, and the issue with combination services, because by itself it doesn't go past the epidermis. However, if the client decides, I want, let's say, a chemical peel, and they do a chemical peel along with the dermaplaning, it will exceed the epidermis. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is it.
Question. Is dermaplaning being done by dermatologists right now?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
I said in salons all over the state.
So dermaplaning kind of like shaving.
Almost. It's basically, yeah. It's the instrument is definitely different. Yeah, the instrument is definitely different, but it's very similar.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay. Go ahead. So all of these services are being done now in the salon, all three of the different categories you just showed.
Okay, so when I looked from state to state, most states it's either done by doctors and or it's done in medical spas. Most states do not allow their estheticians to just perform this in like regular, you know, cosmetology type salons. The FDA has issues with the actual device that's used for microneedling. They issued out a guidance a couple of years ago that suggested if a device says that it can affect a condition like acne or scarring, then it probably should be regulated and not sold to the public.
You're making a bit of a distinction between microneedling, nano infusion, dermaplaning, and that the latter two are not as, don't penetrate the dermis, and is that what your finding was?
Okay, so microneedling definitely penetrates. Like you said, the latter two do not. The issue with the nano infusion may be that if an inspector were to go in a salon, it is going to be very difficult to differentiate if they're doing nano infusion or microneedling, because the tool is basically, it looks exactly the same. And so that definitely can pose an issue. And then with the dermaplaning, it doesn't penetrate the, you know, it doesn't go beyond the epidermis. However, if a client is asking for a peel, there's no way for us to know that that's going on. So definitely, the ball is definitely in y'all court. Relaying the facts.
What do we have before us as far as this issue is concerned? I don't know. Or, like, what are our current regulations about?
Not really addressed in our regulations, but in the past, many, many years ago, we worked with the medical board, because the medical board was citing estheticians for certain procedures, and kind of through discussions, it was, you know, that the cosmetologists work on the epidermis,
right,
and when it gets below that, it needs to be in a medical spa or under the supervision of a physician.
And that makes, I think that should, is that still our position? Is it?
No, that the position has
changed.
Right. We did have a declaratory order on that has reference to that, but that's, it's many years old.
Right. incorporate microdermabrasion is permitted in aesthetic salons.
Right, and the law was changed to. But it kind of was a debate between microdermabrasion and dermabrasion, but dermabrasion removes more things. And at that time, it's also glycolic peels. Some of the prescriptive grades removed more than the epidermis. So those were the two things we were dealing with at that time.
It sounds from what you presented that the microneedling would be something that really would be appropriate in a with a doctor and dermatologist.
Definitely.
Yeah. So go ahead.
I just think it may be difficult to regulate and monitor the other two as well.
This sounds like blading, you know, where we had to address that issue with the blade, and we can no longer do those in the cosmetology salon.
So that's an indication for you to be presenting. Has someone been cited with this practice yet?
Are you asking like, why am I doing this?
No, have anyone been cited with it yet?
I am unsure.
Okay.
Mrs. C said yes, she wants to know why I'm doing it. I was asked to, and I think it was because the school wanted to implement some of these into their program.
Okay.
Yes.
And that's why we're going over this.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
So I need to know the purpose now.
Right.
It's coming up next.
Okay.
Would you like me to address this? I'm the one that sent in the request. Thank you, Chairman and the board. If I may, just read the letter that I sent into the board. I'd like to do that. It was dated July the 27th. The aesthetics industry in Louisiana is growing rapidly, and we are so proud to be part of the training of future aestheticians. One of the services that is being performed in salons and spas in Louisiana is dermaplaning. This is a form of exfoliation treatment that removes dead skin cells to make the skin surface look more youthful, smooth, and radiant. It is very similar to the theory of microdermabrasion without the use of suction and abrasive crystals. As with any type of exfoliation, the removal of dead skin cells allows products to be absorbed more effectively, assist in reducing milia, closed and open comedones, and minor breakouts associated with congested pores. Dermaplaning can be an effective exfoliation method for clients that have couperose sensitive skin or allergies that prevent the use of microdermabrasion or diamond or chemical peels. Another popular technology being used in the aesthetic industry is microneedling or dermal rolling, as was addressed, and nano infusion. Microneedling is a form of collagen injection therapy using tiny needle pricks across the skin with rollers or electronic handpieces to a depth of 0.5 millimeters to 2.5 millimeters. Nano infusion technology, also known as microchanneling, uses a needle-free handpiece with silicone tips and is a non-invasive alternative to microneedling as it only affects the epidermis, treating within the upper 0.25 millimeters of the skin. Guy's Academy has always been on the cutting edge of product and equipment technology. We want to add dermaplaning and nano infusion to our aesthetics program. Our program requires 900 hours and to complete, and we would certainly have enough time to incorporate both of these into our curriculum. So that was basically it. And our aesthetics program is 900 hours, and it has been approved for 900 hours since 1996. We do and also teach the microdermabrasion, which Ms. Mella talked about. So this would just be another thing that we could add to the program. I also have printed out a lesson plan to present if you'd like to see that, client consent forms, and also I have about a dozen salons right now in the state of Louisiana doing dermaplaning.
And you're not talking about microneedling then? It's just...
No.
Dermaplaning and...
Right. I just addressed that in the letter to call the difference.
So it's dermaplaning and nano infusion only?
Yes, yes, sir. And so I would just ask the board, since it is being done all over the state, to allow us to teach it and train the students properly and how to do it before they get a half a day training somewhere and go out and work on the public. Thank you.
Comments, thoughts from the board?
Didn't somebody come and move off that little boy he had in Forrester? They demonstrated it's on us, yeah. A while back.
And Sherry, what's your opinion as far as how, you know, how we're constrained by, you know, the regulatory regime here?
We haven't had any recent conversations with the medical board, but I think their position was that once you remove the epidermis, that it was a medical procedure, so anything would have to be limited to work on the epidermis.
Which is what... What you're saying is those two techniques only work on the epidermis.
Okay, so if you were going to combine a peel and then do that, or, you know, if you were doing something that removed the epidermis first, then it would be outside the scope.
I tried to look up in the curriculum, like in the book, because they were nice enough to send us a very brand new and free My Lady's Aesthetics book to see, like, what was in the book and what did the book say. I saw one paragraph, and then the rest of it just said that basically it was done in a medical spa. So there's nothing like in the actual book. Look, there is something, but like I said, it's maybe a paragraph, maybe two on the three combined.
And again, Kwan, this is a new procedure.
It's actually not. It's just new to cosmetologists and estheticians trying to do it, because dermatologists have been doing it for years.
You mean the microneedling?
Microneedling, dermaplaning, yeah, that's been done.
What we did with the last time is someone submitted a request for a declaratory order, and in a declaratory order proceeding, we have to notify any interested individual. So we notified the medical board so that they had an opportunity to present any information to us. And they had initially said that they were going to present information at the hearing, and then they declined to do so. But when we issued the order, then it's appealable to the district court, and it wasn't appealed. And so that's why that order stands. And you might want to have a similar procedure to not risk people being cited by another board.
Right. I think that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
So what would our order be today then?
Should we try to appeal it and see what they'll do?
Really, you should ask somebody to submit a petition for declaratory order, and we set it for hearing. You could take into consideration the information that was presented today by Ms. Birch and also by our staff. And then if anybody else wants to submit additional information, we can post it on the website. So if there are other estheticians or other licensees or medical spa people that want to send in information, we can send it to the medical board. And then that could all be taken into consideration before we issue an order if the licensees can provide.
I just have one question. So if our board allows this to happen, they can't go any further than, you know, not penetrate. How do we know it's not going to excel and then start doing other things because we've given them that little opportunity?
Open the door.
I'm not being ugly, I just...
Do you have an answer for that?
I'm sorry, what was your question again?
I'm saying, taking into consideration some of the things that needs to be done with the legislature, I just want to know if the board allows this to happen, to give y'all the consent, you know, to go ahead and have the hours and do that dermaplaning. If y'all not going to take a step further,
and do more than what is required?
Well, I would welcome the board to come in, send the inspectors in, however they wanted to monitor what was going on in our school. But we want to teach the students the right way to do it. We want to teach them, like has been brought out, not to be doing peels in conjunction with it, because a lot of these printouts that I did for these salons all over the state, they are doing peels and they are doing dermaplaning the very same day. And I would ask the board, if they're going to be looking for some kind of an order, that any salon in Louisiana right now currently doing this needs to be shut down. It needs to stop.
And I think you're right.
Because they're working on the public, and, you know, there's a lot of them out there.
Once it is in effect, or might be in effect, to make sure that our laws towards that is
Yeah. And you need inspectors to properly inspect it to regulate.
Right. Right.
To know differentially the difference.
And we do periodic inspections of the schools, so we would be able to send inspectors in.
Yeah.
And
at least at least twice a year.
Right.
Usually more.
But once you open up an aesthetic salon, then from there we need to make sure that they're properly doing the right thing.
They're not being properly inspected because they're doing these services. You don't even have to see them doing it. You can look on their websites. They're advertising it.
Right. And that's where the fines come in, because we're not a medical board.
Right.
Well, to me, it seems that the whole issue with the, when you talk about epidermis and above, we can do that. Epidermis and below the epidermis, we can't. That makes it, in a way, it's a nice, pretty simple rule. Yes?
Hi, I wanted to bring up something that is relevant to this conversation. So I work for the Aveda Institutes, but not just the ones here in Louisiana. I actually work for our institutes across 9 states. So I get to deal and see with what other states are doing in addition to Louisiana. And one thing that's actually going through right now in our Minnesota school in Minneapolis is they just approved an advanced aesthetics program to address these issues themselves. And it launched August 1st of last month. So there are other states out there that are utilizing this curriculum. Miladies has an advanced aesthetics program that already has lessons built in, its own textbook. So I think this is an issue that I strongly support in addition to other schools in the state. And I think I understand that with the medical field, it's something that we definitely need to look into, but it's possible, it's feasible, is what I want to say. And if there are questions about what does that curriculum look like, how many hours does that program take, and then what does the onboarding process look like for current estheticians and cosmetologists in the state that have an interest in this program, I think it's definitely worth looking into that process. And in other states that have been acting or moving towards this in their laws, it's about a year and a half long process. But like I said, we have states already that are currently using these practices and allowing their estheticians right now to graduate school with an AP license after an additional 500 hours of school. And it allows them to do specifically the dermaplaning in addition to exfoliation services, chemical peels, advanced facial treatments, and the skin needling that we talked about today.
So what you're saying is they would do additional hours in their state
in Minnesota. Yes, they do additional hours. It's a separate program. So currently any student going through their esthetician program, which there in their state is only 600 hours, in Louisiana it's 750, so they do less hours than we do here to begin with. But their estheticians are licensed to do normal aesthetic services. However, they recently, with the installment of this AP program, they removed the estheticians being able to use a lancet. They can only do manual extractions with gloves in their hands. In the AP program, it's an additional 500 hours on top of their esthetician license, but their AP license replaces their aesthetic license. cosmetologist, including if they wanted to be able to perform these services, such as microneedling, dermaplaning, they would have to go to school for the additional program. There is a way to grandfather current licensed people in. Again, I'm referencing Minnesota because that's what I've been working with. They allow their current estheticians and cosmetologists to submit supporting documentation saying that they have 900 hours of experience in the salon performing these services, and then they grandfather them in and give them an AP license. But like I said, this program went into effect last month, and we're launching this program in our school in 2 months.
But they don't have microneedling.
They do. In their state documentation, it says microneedling limited to the epidermis layer of the skin. It is very specific in there, so they're using the term microneedling, whereas we're using the term nano infusion. But it's the same procedure. They're allowing that and dermaplaning and glycolic peels up to 50%.
Okay, I'm gonna ask, what's AP license?
An advanced practice license. So in their state, if you have an esthetology or an esthetician license that says advanced practice in front of it, it allows you to do this list of services, whereas a regular esthetician license only allows the manual cleansing, manipulation, makeup application services that we currently allow.
Thank you.
Yeah. We're just two lawyers, so the way Minneapolis has done it makes a lot of sense. But we need legislation, to be able to do it. And I kind of feel like that's where we are, as far as these techniques have come along and our law is not really clear, and we need to go back to the legislature and look at doing some sort of advanced practice license.
Because that's what I was going to ask. How would we be able to differentiate a school that teaches it and they get an aesthetics license from a school that doesn't teach it and they get the same aesthetics license?
This is the problem. This is exactly the problem. Because we need a real program, we need an approved curriculum, we need an approved textbook. And yes, Mr. Young.
Well, actually, the problem would only come in if you did not create an advanced aesthetics program. As long as we continue with the 750 hours in aesthetics for our aesthetics, any school is teaching 750, a person can get aesthetics license. The advanced aesthetics license would be the addition of these things in a curriculum and called advanced aesthetics license. So we'd have to have two aesthetics licenses. Yeah.
But then that would still have to go before legislation.
Maybe we wouldn't need a whole 500 since we already have 750. Maybe we could do it.
Well, you could probably do the 900 or the, 900 more than likely.
Yeah.
900.
But that would definitely have to go before legislation.
But it would have to go before legislation. Yes.
As I mentioned, our school hours have been 900 hours, and we are one of only two schools in the state that teach microdermabrasion, and we certify our students, and they have to do a certain number of them, and then when they go to board, they can get their permit. So even if you would consider the dermaplaning to get a permit to do that, that way you can definitely control that when the inspectors come in, someone's doing it, they could look for that permit. So even if you feel like that the nano infusion at this point is maybe something you don't want to go to, the dermaplaning, I feel, is just another form of exfoliation. I would request that you seriously consider letting us add that, because it is just an exfoliation treatment. It's not puncturing the skin in any way. Really similar to microdermabrasion without the crystals and the suction that occurs with it.
I kind of want to add it to her question. The question was, you wanted to know how they can control how deep they go.
Yeah.
We do chemical peels right now. We do microdermabrasions. If a student or someone in the salon turns up the microdermabrasion, they can penetrate past the epidermis. If they go to another company and get a higher percentage of appeal, how do y'all control appeals? How do y'all control that? Okay, so you got people out here that are teaching dermaplaning right now that are not licensed estheticians, they're not licensed instructors. We're asking, because we're licensed, we want to teach people how to do it correctly versus these people out here that are doing it now, not even licensed to do it. But we're trying to teach people how to do it correctly. You got Louis Phillips here that wants to do things correctly, and that's why we bring it to you guys.
That's great. We just need to get legislation.
Yeah, I mean, we could submit legislation on this session, you know, right. That upcoming session in January. So, if that's what you guys, is that what you guys feel like we should do, rather than just approving a program to do an advanced practice license?
Well, we're gonna have to do what's right. So we have to take the first step if we have to go to legislation first.
That's what I'm at.
Yeah.
Do you agree?
I agree.
Yes. Mr. Dixon, are you good thoughts?
Also, we would need to modify our administrative rules because currently we don't allow blades in our shops.
Right. It would be, this would be a whole new training.
Right. So I'm just saying that, right. Just on record, that we would have to do that as well.
Agreed.
Well, what about the dermaplaning?
I think this is all part of it.
Yeah, the dermaplaning is what I'm talking about, like, because you have to use a blade, and, you know, we kicked out keto blades and all of that.
Okay, well, the nano infusion, because there was someone that came here.
I'm sorry, but you do allow blades. How do you think we do a razor cut?
Sure.
Not if you get cut off.
What is it?
What?
It's on the skin.
What? It's a razor.
No, razor cut on the hair.
Right.
Yeah, we don't have razors.
Bring your bullet straight back. That's the hair. But the actual barber is where it comes in attached to the skin.
Right.
Okay, so I think at this point, we've talked about this, you know, a good bit, and it sounds to me like the consensus on the board from the board is that we should approach the legislature on getting some sort of advanced license similar to what you mentioned in Minnesota. And then we can, is staff willing to do some work on that? And we could, you know, you are? Is that okay?
Of course.
And then if we can just perhaps, you think you could get something put together for the next meeting for us to consider?
Absolutely, yeah.
All right.
Because I know it's like, time to get our stuff together for legislation, like whatever we're gonna. Gotcha.
And anything else, you know, that you guys, that staff feels like we need to address the legislature, we can do it at that time.
Awesome.
Okay.
I'm staff, by the way.
Nobody knows I'm staff.
Sorry.
To make a copy of her list of that way we kind of.
And I don't think we need it. We'll take, you know, we don't need to take any action on that. It's just a project, and we can vote on it when we get there. But I think that's a better way to go instead of just approving a one-off, you know, to just get it together correctly. Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
Ma'am.
Good. Everyone agrees?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Then I would like to also have the board address all the salons and spas in the state of Louisiana that are currently doing microblading. It needs to come to a stop.
Microblading, microneedling.
Dermaplaning, I'm sorry. Yeah, dermaplaning. And they're doing it all over the place.
Okay, thank you.
So I'll request that.
Thank you. Very interesting.
Next on the list, after advanced aesthetics, was there anybody else anything to say about advanced aesthetics? Is the continuing education work that one of
Yes, the board had asked that Debbie look up, go through the states and see about the continuing education for cosmetology. And so if you look in your agenda, you'll find two pages here of all the states. There were 22 states that had no continuing education, 11 others that had instructors only. So 33 of the 50 states have either none or only for instructors. So the board had spoken briefly about needing or some possibly doing some continuing education for cosmetology. So that's what this is. And if there's any further discussion, it'll be before the board.
Well, if the continuing education, would we have to put like the aesthetics in there with the cosmetology?
It would be a program that we would have to create.
Yeah.
But I think this really is specifically
just for
is referring to hair.
Yeah.
That's correct.
That, I'm just asking about the other. But I think so.
Mm-hmm. You're asking if once we approve continuous education, would it be across the board? Is that what you're asking?
Right.
I think it probably would, it would, logically it would be, right? If you're going to do it for hair, why would you do it for skin?
Right.
Right.
Big question.
It looks to me like 17 states are doing it. I don't know if it's something we want to do or not. I guess I would defer to my fellow board members on this. Looks like Texas is our neighbors. Texas is doing it. Mississippi is not.
Arkansas is not.
Yeah, Texas goes online.
It's online.
Mm-hmm.
I had an email from someone from Illinois, and Illinois went on and added that if there was not taking something for pertaining to hair, they offered a domestic abuse course for the students, as a continuous education. That was very interesting.
Yeah, I don't know if you're familiar with the Cut It Out Foundation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah,
so.
Of course. Yeah. Yeah, I know that
it's a strong organization.
It really is a strong organization, and I mean that's something to consider because, as I know the people in this room know, we can be some of the first, in our industry, some of the first people who see evidence of
domestic abuse.
Yeah. And there's there could be non-technical types of continuing education that we could implement.
Which I thought was very interesting.
Where do the school owners stand on continuing education?
For licensed operators?
Practitioners.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Practitioners.
Well, I think as long as it's made available to take online, I think it would be great. It's hard enough as school owners to get an organization of school owners to come every other year and get continuing education, but I think if something's online, I think it'd be great.
Yeah, I'm in favor for it. I've been doing this for a long time, so I'm great having community.
And I hear from a lot of hairdressers I talk to, they are in favor of it, the ones I've spoken to.
And being online, I think, would be a really good thing too, because they're so used to going there now. That's
the way. That's the future.
Yeah, so I think it's good.
They already come to school watching YouTube thinking they know how to do everything.
You're right. I call it YouTube University.
Yeah, it's great for business. But speaking from a standpoint of continuing ed, just on their instructor side, to get that level of people to realize they got to have continuing ed, I can't imagine telling a stylist.
Right.
And trying to get them to be accountable. But I do believe once you put some in place, it just becomes the norm. Yeah. And it's what it's expected.
It's a part of renewing the license.
Yeah, it is. I think it's great. Nurses do it, everybody else does it.
Mr. Young,
it couldn't be just part of renewing your license because they received a license without having to do that. Most of them have been renewing their license for 30 or 40 years, and you're going to have to go in and put a grandfather's clause for everyone who holds a current license, and it would start with every new license, not every old license.
Mm-hmm.
think you mentioned something that I think this had to pass through legislators.
This
yes.
Is there a reason why, I mean, why is it, why do we feel we need it? Is there a reason why it's money?
It was something Ms. Ayers brought to the table.
Yeah. Just wondering, you know, trying to find out what we can do to help. So, I mean, if nobody's on board, they don't feel they need it.
And
that's
with
all.
With the industry being an evolving industry, and education is at the forefront. I mean, I myself have family members who are licensed, haven't been to a hair show educational in years, but renewing their license and still practicing with some really antiquated styles, antiquated techniques.
As long as they're getting paid
for
it, I guess they're doing a good job.
Yeah.
So are we talking about techniques and styles, or are we talking about sanitation and safety?
That's also, too, taking consideration.
Because
yeah.
That's all that we do here. We don't do, like, we can't require people to, like,
right.
update their license if they take a class on technique and our styles.
Yeah.
Like,
right.
it would have to be safety
yeah.
and sanitation,
yeah,
which
one.
Technically
right.
doesn't really change to have somebody do it. Every year, like, how much does sanitation actually change? Like, it doesn't. So what would they be getting continuing education on in terms of safety and sanitation? Because that's what we do here. Like, I think that's a great idea as far as, like, voluntary, but just to make it a requirement, what we do is safety and sanitation.
And that's Texas.
There's several other states. So again, the nine states that I have to work in, I have licenses in them, and about half of them require me to do continuing education. And the majority of those states, it's only 3 to 4 hours every 3 years, and it's usually a sanitation infection class or a blood safety class, like a blood spill safety class. Most of the states, it has nothing to do with a technical skill. One of the states, it is a technical skill. But you can, there's a list of like 60 schools and salons across the state that offer like a weekend class on a technical skill, and all you have to do is sign up and pay for the class and show your receipt, and they consider that you're continuing ed. And a lot of these states, the continuing ed hours transfer from state to state as well.
Okay, it doesn't sound like we're any consensus to move forward with anything on continuing education today. Then, Mr. Young, you had something on here about an eyelash extension letter. Is that?
That's my job to do since the last board meeting, but I've been in Montana for 2 weeks, so I'll get on it this week.
So we're gonna push that back to next week.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That concludes the old business. Mr. Young, the new business?
Mr. Chairman, I've received several more calls from cosmetologists, estheticians, wanting to do teeth whitening in a salon. So I don't know exactly if the teeth whitening is something that, of course, the dental board might be against, but is it a procedure where you're just selling a tooth whitening product that can be bought at CVS, Walgreens, Walmart, or somewhere else? But I'd like the board to discuss whether or not something like tooth whitening is one of these new things that all of a sudden is in cosmetology, or if it's something that is not in cosmetology and that we shouldn't have in the salons. I just, you'll be surprised though, all of a sudden something will come on internet and everybody wants to do tooth whitening. So they all call on the same day. So, but anyway, Mr. Chairman, just as a subject for a few moments.
Okay.
Well, first of all, we're trying to get thermabrasion and everything else. Instead of going after teeth whitening. I'm not being an ugly person, but I mean, let's get on board here and do what we need to do. I think this, you can go you know, like you said, CVS and all these other places, you can do it yourself at home.
Thank you, Mr. Martin. Any comments?
Well, that's bringing me back to back in the barber days, remember, dentistry was a barber. I myself, I think we should touch that. We have our hands.
We don't. I don't think we have any.
So if the board is giving the director an indication, what is it? One they call.
I think
we still do not do that.
We don't. Yeah, that's not something that we regulate or that we're. It's not really part of our ambit of what we do, and it's something they should take up with the dentistry board.
Were they doing that in a salon and get caught, is it going to be?
I think that's a.
Depends on if it's a regulated practice. If it's regulated by another board, then it's not something you can do without a license. If it's an unregulated practice, then anybody can do it wherever.
I mean, you can't go to the dentist and get your teeth whitened.
Well, I think we would probably need to do more research on as to what extent it's regulated in Louisiana. You know, the North Carolina Board of Dental case is kind of a famous. With the FTC.
So do we need to reach out to the dental board?
Yeah, why should we do that?
It doesn't fit within the definition of cosmetology because teeth are not included in our definition. But, you know, if it's an unlicensed practice.
Then we can't.
Then
there's nothing that's said in the law. Let me just see if I'm paraphrasing you correct. There's nothing in the law or the regulations that say you can't. There's nothing that we can do to stop it. Is that what you're saying?
Right, but the dental board might, certain practices might be within the scope of dentistry, and then you might need some sort of permit or training or license to do that practice in Louisiana, but it's under the scope of another board.
Well, we can stop it in our shops, right?
Yes, but
no.
It's regulated.
We're sure not gonna have it.
Yes, ma'am.
I think one of the problems is whenever, young people go to hair shows and skincare shows, they have booths such as teeth whitening and other various things that are really out of the scope of practice. And they think just because they're there that it's okay for them to do it.
Yeah.
But I personally don't see it out in the world of salons. I don't think I've ever seen, I've probably been in a couple thousand salons, I don't think I've ever seen a teeth whitening on that. Except there was one in Birmingham that had a dentist office attached, and they have
it. Well, I didn't see it done, but I saw it advertised.
You did? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so maybe it's out there.
So, Mr. Young, you had several requests pertaining to this?
Well, people called and said, we're doing teeth whitening in the salons. What are you going to do about it? And someone would call and say, I took a course, and I'd like to do this in my salon, and is it all right with the board? And another one called, said the same thing, another one called. So there was some course out there that they could pay for and take it. Now they're wanting to know if, since they took some course on the internet, if they're regulated by us, so that.
That's what we got. Yes?
Other practice that's regulated by another board or not regulated, like massage therapy is regulated by another board, and that's pretty common in salons, but they have to follow the rules and the training and the licensure requirements of that board. And so if teeth whitening is covered by our dental board, they're going to have to comply with all those rules. If it's not covered, if it's just an unlicensed practice, then it's an unlicensed practice. I just don't know the answer to that with respect to teeth whitening.
I would imagine that it would have to be
dental
board
may
have like we did for microblading, you know, and so that they would be licensed by the dermatology board or whoever governs people whitening teeth.
I would think it would be the dental board if it's
Okay.
And, Mr. Chairman, one other thing, foreign credentials evaluation review. Kiwan has notice something that needs to, we need to at least bring before the board and talk about Kiwan, if you would.
Okay, so during a recent investigation, it was revealed that some of our already approved evaluation companies had extremely lax standards and requirements for evaluating. So they specifically, some companies were not verifying the licenses. So like when we have an individual who is trying to transfer a foreign license, we require them to pick a person off of our list and have their license and their high school education evaluated by a company. We'll come to find out, some of the companies were not even requiring them to send in like original documents. And so in a case that I just closed, there were tons of like non-legit licenses coming in, and some of the companies were like, yeah, it's legit, but in the fine print it says that they receive like copies of all of the credentials as opposed to official transcripts and requesting originals and stuff like that. So it's in my opinion that authentication of licenses is like the key basis of evaluating a license. So initially we had 28 companies that we approved, and I vetted the 28, and of the 28, it was down to 10. And all of these 10 companies were already approved, so I guess technically what I'm asking is to have the other 18 removed. And all of these companies require a submission of the original license, submission of their professional, you know, their transcript from when they went to cosmetology, manicures, or whatever school, and official high school transcripts. So this is, they are very thorough, and so when we get an evaluation back, I just feel like it'll be more, you know, authentic and well vetted because the other people did not.
Comments or questions?
No, I think that we should approve, you know, the 10. If our staff believes that, you know,
agreed.
Thank you. Just to be able to reduce the number, because when folks who are having who may have fraudulent credentials, if they realize that a particular company does not check those credentials, they're going to pick up on that and tell every other person who's got forged credentials to use that company. So if we can reduce this down to the 10 who actually check and see, we would be much better off.
It's very detailed.
Yes, I think
very
so.
Detailed. Good job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Would someone like to make a motion to approve this?
And have
this?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, this is the list is approved. And only the list.
Only the list.
Only the list.
Ms. Angelosi, are you, did you have anything else, Mr. Young, before we move on?
No, sir.
Angela,
the case was set for hearing at 1:00. It's Sabella Borges doing business as Sabella Beauty Salon and Spa. It's now a few minutes after 2:00 and she's not present. I was checking the file and the notice of the hearing that was sent to her on August 9th, it was sent to the address of record where we did the inspections. It was returned to sender unclaimed, unable to forward. Tasha, you don't know if we got the regular mailings back, do we?
No, ma'am, we did not.
Okay, so under the statute, you can go forward with this case for hearing today in her absence because we sent it to her address of record, both certified and regular mail. So you'll know what the case is about. She was at one point a cosmetology student. And on 2 days, on May 18th last year and December 18th last year, she was found operating as a cosmetologist without a license and operating the cosmetology salon without a license. What we're asking you to do is to have her forfeit her student hours, which the rules allow when you are a cosmetology student and you operate as a cosmetologist before being licensed. And we're also asking you to, as part of your order, find that before any license for this individual be approved, that she would have to appear before the board. She doesn't have a license application now. I thought once the violations were entered that she would have come and apply for a license, or either the salon would apply for a license. but neither happened. And I haven't had any contact with her. There's not been any phone calls or anything.
So you want to go proceed with the default?
Yeah, I might as well. I think so. The boy's pleasure. I don't know what else to do to get her here. All right.
Go ahead and proceed.
Tosh.
You solemnly swear that the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, so help me God.
Yes. Ms. Butler, would you state your name for the record, please?
Natasha Butler.
And where are you employed?
Louisiana State Board of Cosmetology.
And what's your title?
Administrative Program Specialist.
Ms. Butler, let me give you one more example. Are you familiar with the licensing file for an individual? Sabella Borges, Sabella, S-O-B-E-L-L-A, last name Borges, B-O-R-G-E-S. It was a cosmetology student, number 2234.
Yes, ma'am.
So, Ms. Borges is never licensed by our board as a cosmetologist, was she?
No, she was not.
Okay, and how was she registered with the board?
As a student.
And did she ever go past the student stage? Did she ever submit all her hours or anything or apply for licensing?
No, ma'am.
I want you to look at board exhibits 2, 4, and 5 and ask if you recognize those documents.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, you know what board exhibit 2 is?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you tell us what that is?
Yes, ma'am. Board exhibit number 2 is the informal hearing notice sent to Ms. Sabella Borges at the address of record.
Okay. Look at board exhibit 2 for me, if you would. It's dated October 5th, 2018, right?
Yes, ma'am.
And is sent to Sabella Ponto Borges and or Sabella D. Brito Erazo, doing business as Sabella Beauty Salon and Spa, 429 Wall Boulevard, number 4, Gretna, Louisiana.
Yes, ma'am.
And it was sent certified mail return receipt requested?
Correct.
And can you tell if that was received at the address of record? There's a printout from the post office.
It was delivered to an individual at that address at 1248 p.m. on October 10, 2010.
Okay, and so look at the letter clearly, if you would. It's 2 pages. And look at the attachment and tell me again what this letter is.
The informal hearing notice, the cease and desist order for Sabella Borges.
Okay, so it was a cease and desist letter dated October 5th, 2018, is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
And it's telling them to cease operating as a cosmetology salon without a license, and you have to have all your individuals working there licensed?
Correct.
An offering evidence board exhibit 2 is identified by the witness.
The exhibit's accepted.
Okay, look at board exhibit 4 if you would. And that's another certified mailing sent to Sabella Borges at doing business at Sabella's Beauty Salon and Spa at the same address in Gretna.
Yes, ma'am.
Stated February 6, 2019.
Yes, ma'am.
And what is that letter?
It's also a cease and desist order.
And can you tell, and it was the same cease and desist operating a cosmetology salon and operating as a cosmetologist without a license?
Yes, ma'am.
And can you tell if that mailing was received at the address of record?
Yes, it was received on February 17, 2019.
Okay, and offering evidence board exhibit 4 as identified by the witness.
The exhibit's accepted.
Thanks. And Ms. Butler, can you look at board exhibit 5? Okay. And what's board exhibit 5? What's the date of board exhibit 5?
August 9th, 2019.
Okay, and it's sent to Sabella Borges doing business as Sabella's Beauty Salon and Spa?
Yes, ma'am.
And it's sent to that same address where the salon was in Gretna and also to another address that we found in Marrero?
That's correct.
And what is this letter?
It's the notice of a hearing for today's date, September 9th, 2019 at 1 o'clock.
Okay, and it has the administrative complaint attached?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, did you get any return mailings, any green cards, or anything on these certified mailings?
The certified mail was returned to the office on August the 12th. According to the post office, it was unclaimed.
Okay, and that's the one sent to the Marrero address, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And the one sent to the Gretna address, we didn't find out about it in any way, did we?
No, ma'am.
All right, I'd offer an evidence board exhibit 5 as identified by this witness.
The exhibit's accepted.
Ms. Butler, since the date of these violations, which was May 18th and December 18th of 2018, have you checked the records of this office to
yes.
determine whether Sabella's Beauty Salon and Spa at 429 Wall Boulevard, number 4, Gretna, Louisiana, has become licensed as a cosmetology salon?
Yes, ma'am, I have checked and they are not licensed as of yet.
And the individual owner, Sabella Brito Borges, did you check to see whether she had become licensed as a cosmetologist?
She also is not licensed as of yet.
Okay, and she's still a student status?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, that's all the questions I have of Ms. Butler.
Thank you, Ms. Butler. Any questions from Ms. Butler?
To raise your right hand, please. Do you solemnly swear that the testimony you have to give to be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth? So help you God.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Porter, will you state your name for us, please?
Nita Porter.
And where are you employed?
With the LSBC Board of Cosmetology.
And what's your job?
Inspector.
Do you cover a certain area?
I do.
Okay. What is that area?
The river parishes from the West Bank of New Orleans to just about Randall.
Oh, wow. Okay, the Gulf.
Wow.
All right. Does your area cover Gretna, Louisiana?
It does.
Okay. Have you ever had occasion to inspect or be at a salon called Sabella's Beauty Salon and Spa on Wall Boulevard in Gretna, Louisiana?
Yes.
How many times did you go there?
Twice.
Okay, I'm just giving you two exhibits, Board 1 and Board 3. Can you tell us what Board 1 is? What date is it?
May the 18th of 2018.
Okay, and so, is this an inspection report at Sabella's Beauty Salon and Spa on that day?
Yes.
Okay, and what did you observe on that day?
I observed a non-licensed beauty salon with, there were customers, clients within the salon, performing healthcare services. There wasn't any license present for salon or operators.
Okay. And was one of the operators, the person you identified as the owner, Sabella, what is it? What's the middle name? Sabella Borges?
Yes.
Okay. So was she operating without a license?
Yes.
And the salon, did you check our records to see if the salon was licensed?
I did.
And it was it?
It was not.
Okay. So you wrote on your violation report, what did you write on that on page 2?
Operating a hair salon without salon or operator licenses.
Okay, and what did you write on page 1 of the report at the bottom?
Violation number 45399, open for business 2 years, operating a hair salon without salon or Louisiana operator's license.
Okay, where did you get the idea that it was open for business for 2 years?
From the occupational license that was in the salon.
Okay, so they had an occupational license and that salon name, it was 2 years old, or it had been in existence
two years prior to my inspection.
All right. So you're assuming based on that that the salon had been operating since that time?
Yes.
I'd like to offer an evidence board exhibit 1 as identified by the witness.
The exhibit's accepted.
Okay, let's look at board exhibit 3. What is that?
It says inspection report I did about 6 months later.
Okay, and what's the date of that one?
December the 18th of 2018.
And it's again at Sabella's Beauty Salon and Spa on Wall Boulevard in Gretna.
Correct.
And the owner is identified as Sabella Borges.
It is.
Okay, and what did you observe on that occasion?
the salon was still open. I hadn't been there to license them, but they were still operating without any licenses.
And did Ms. Borges, okay, without any license, it didn't have a salon license, right?
It didn't have a salon license.
And what about the operators that were there?
None of the operators were licensed, but she presented a Puerto Rico license.
Mm-hmm. And did y'all discuss the validity of that license?
We did.
What was the discussion?
Basically, I told her that that license from Puerto Rico, it didn't have any variance on Louisiana, and that she would need to come to the board, bring her Puerto Rico license so she can do what's called reciprocity, so she can obtain a Louisiana license to practice cosmetology in Gretna.
Who was the Puerto Rico license? Was it a cosmetologist license?
It was a cosmetologist license.
All right. I'd like to offer you evidence board exhibit 3 as identified by the witness.
The exhibit's accepted.
So that's December 18th, but also you were there earlier on May 18th of 2018. Did you have a similar discussion with her at that time?
No, because there wasn't a license present at that time.
Okay. But there wasn't a license present either day, right?
Either.
Okay. All right. That's all the questions I have for...
Just two quick questions. How many operators were present, do you remember?
About 3.
About 3. And what kind of services were they performing?
They were blow drying, flat ironing. They're from Puerto Rico, so they do a lot of Brazilian blowouts, which is kind of popular in the area now.
So they were cosmetology services?
Yes.
Any other questions? Thank you.
I just want to make one statement in the way of closing. It's confusing because of the order that I offered the exhibits, because Ms. Butler had to testify as to the cease and desist orders. But after May 18th, the first time Ms. Porter was in there, we sent the first cease and desist order. Again, after December 18th, the second time she still found him operating without a license, we sent the second cease and desist order. And what we're asking you to do is find Ms. Borges in violation and apply the rule that says that it can invalidate and she would forfeit her student hours. And also to say that before any license would be issued for any salon at that location by that owner, she'd have to come and appear before the board. And I have proposed findings of fact and conclusions of law to submit.
You said there was 3 operators in that salon. They were all unlicensed?
They were all unlicensed.
Only one had a license from Puerto Rico.
It's Sabella, the owner. She does have a license from Puerto Rico.
Mm-hmm. Has everyone had time to review the findings?
Yes.
It's a $1,200 fine and forfeiture of hours and appear before the board. Yes. Someone want to make a motion or any discussion on the finding of fact, conclusions of law, proposed order?
So we're going to act to assist and desist the shop again, to close the shop?
Yes.
Since they have no license.
Is Kendra a student?
What we're.
Ms. Abra had a question.
Because she was a student, we have jurisdiction over her, and we could fine them for operating without a license. We sent two cease and desist orders, and under the law, the cease and desist order says if they don't cease and desist at 2 days after service, then we can bring this here. And that's what we've done.
Right. But do we have the opportunity to close the shop?
I don't think that we close the shop. We just say your operation is illegal. I mean, we can't. We can't close it, Ms. Morris. We'd have to file suit for injunction in district court. So that we'd have to file pleadings in Gretna district court to enforce that.
Right.
Which is kind of time consuming and costly.
It is. Mm-hmm. But if they continue to operate,
then that's a lot.
We'll have to do that.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay. Any other questions?
No. Question.
Can we hear a motion to approve the findings of fact?
No, I'll make a motion to approve the findings of fact.
And the conclusion law and the order.
Yes.
And the order.
Second?
I'll second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
The findings of fact, conclusions of law, and the post order.
Thank you. Thank you. That concludes the hearings for today. Thank you, Ms.
Thank you so much. The last thing on the agenda is some discussion of some litigation that was filed. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, before we go into that, let me recognize Robin Rios and the members of the LAX board who are here, I guess, just to be here, but didn't get up and say anything about the LAX meeting coming up. But just to recognize them, thank them for their work this year, putting this LAX seminar that will be starting next Saturday, and maybe if they have anything just to...
Well, I want to start by saying thank you very much for organizing it. You guys do a real service to our industry, and it's very important. I wish I could attend this year. I am already scheduled to be out of town, but I want to know your efforts are... We definitely recognize your efforts. So would you guys like to say anything?
I'll speak. Again, it is starting this Saturday, and we have had a long year putting this together. We would really like for anybody that can attend. I'm not quite sure. I think we were still waiting to see who was attending as far as board members, if anyone was coming. So we're waiting on the list, but we would love to see y'all there. I do believe, are y'all going to have a table? I believe.
Yep.
So normally, yeah.
Yeah.
And we have the testers information that's already put together to be able to give out to the attendees and everything. But it's a good thing that we do it, and we do appreciate y'all approving our situations at all times. Any suggestions, we're always open for that as a board. If there's anything that y'all would like to bring forward, usually you have a lot of good conversation with me when we have the seminar.
Thank you.
And I appreciate
next year's
that a lot.
Our big one.
So,
next year's our big one.
Yeah, it is 50 years next year, so we will have that in the packet. I was a little confused on the date though, but 50 years is next year, so
How soon will you have the date of the conference?
When we go to the conference, the board will meet with and decide if we're going to have it at the same venue, if not. But we're hoping by December to have that date, because we do like the board to have it on their website. It is a great resource. Again, it's schools that put this on, so it takes a lot of that out of the school calling. They get to go directly to state board. But I'm hoping by December with the board approving dates. And we normally will probably try to still keep it in September that year out. The only way it'll change, like you know, is if they cannot accommodate the September dates that we're requesting. But I'm hoping by December. Do y'all feel we need it any sooner, these dates, for any reason? Yeah.
Perfect.
Okay. All right.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, everyone. Okay. So that concludes our regular business. The last item on the agenda is our attorney's report and to discuss an executive session pending litigation regarding hair braiding. So with that, we'll go ahead and adjourn the regular meeting and move into the motion.
I'll make the motion to adjourn the regular meeting going to executive session.
Second. All in favor, say aye.
Restroom.
Thank you, everyone. So we'll take like 5 minutes and then come back.
Yeah. Make a move to go back into our regular
session. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, we're back in regular session. Is there any more business that we need to handle today? Motion. Anything from the board?
No.
Hear a motion to adjourn?
Make a motion to adjourn.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.